Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's professional lunch at the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. I'm Anthony Rowley, a former president of the club, and at very short notice, I'm acting as moderator. Unfortunately, Martin Curling, one of our senior members, is not too well, although he's bravely shown up, but despite the fact that he's suffering from incipient influenza. Anyway, you'll have to forgive me, if my presentation is not as polished as Martin's would have been. Anyway, it's my pleasure to introduce today's guest, who is Mr. Klaus Regling, who is the founding managing director of the European Stability Mechanism. The European Stability Mechanism, as probably many of you will remember, is the successor to the European Financial Stability Facility, EFSF. And Mr. Regling has had a truly long and distinguished career as an economist, as one might say, as an international financial diplomat. He served for a number of years at the IMF in Washington and also in Jakarta at the office there. And from there, he went on to the German Finance Ministry, where he did a lot of work on preparing for European Monetary Union. Subsequent to that, he served for a short period as a hedge fund manager, I think that's correct, I would say, and also did a stint as a professor at the Lee Kuan Yew School in Singapore. And he then took over, or rather moved to the European Commission, the European Financial Affairs Office. So that's essentially where he is now at the ESM. He's going to talk today about Europe after the crisis. Well, one might ask which crisis, because there have been a number of crises. But essentially, he's going to talk about Europe's really quite remarkable recovery in many ways following the global financial crisis and also the European crisis. And there may well be lessons, I think, there to be learned for, shall we say, China and other countries, because Europe really does seem to be on the road to recovery from the very deep crisis that it suffered some years ago. So I'm not going to say any more, if Mr. Regling will forgive me for being rather brief. I'd just like to welcome two other guests today, who are Mr. Christoph Frenkel, who is a member of the management board of the European Stability Mechanism, who's seated over there, together with Wolfgang Preussel, who is the head of communications and chief spokesperson at the ESM. So I'll hand over to Mr. Regling. Let me remind you first, please switch off your cell phones or put them on manner mode. So please join me in welcoming today's speaker.
Thank you very much, Anthony. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here and to talk to you about Europe. And indeed, I will talk as an economist about economic aspects mainly. There are many crises around the world, not only in Europe, unfortunately, that happens all over the world. So I will talk about our economic issues of the past and how we are getting out of the euro crisis. Of course, there are new problems in Europe. I will touch on them very briefly, but the main topic is the euro crisis and how we handle that. This is the structure of my presentation. I think you also have hard copies, but it's also on the screen. So as you probably know, the economy is returning to a normal situation, although the new normal, like in many other parts of the world, might be a bit different from the old normal. There are some bright spots, there are also weaknesses, there are risks, but basically we are moving back to normal. The crisis, and that's the main part of my presentation, has brought Europe more closely together. This is what happens in crisis, particularly in Europe. And you will hear what are the main elements of our crisis response, and I will also say at the end a few words of what else needs to be done. This chart just shows how growth has been doing the last 7-8 years. The thick red line, that's the euro area average. And here one can see quite well that unfortunately Europe was hit by two crises. And to understand what happened in Europe the last 6-7 years, one has to be aware that we were hit by two crises. The first one was the global financial crisis triggered in the United States, and basically the entire world was hit by that, including Europe. And then we had the second crisis 2-3 years later. That was the euro crisis, homegrown crisis. We cannot blame anybody for that. That was the result of some weaknesses in the initial design of monetary union and some wrong policies. But it was this combination of two crises within a short period of time that in the end led to the worst economic situation in Europe in 80 years. But now you see we are back to normal with growth rates approaching 2% for this year and the forecast for next year. Also encouraging when the IMF revised its economic forecast a few days ago, the euro area was the only economic area where the forecast went up, was revised upward marginally, while most other parts of the world there were downward revisions. So that also confirms that we are back on track. And back on track means that on a per capita basis, growth in Europe will again be very similar to the United States. I think in Japan, this is probably better known than in many other parts of the world, that one must take into account population developments to understand the economy. Demographic trends in Japan are not very positive, to say the least. Europe is a few years behind Japan. But one has to take out these population developments to see that on a GDP per capita growth basis, the growth numbers in Europe have been identical with the United States over the last 30 years. Until 2009. And it's this GDP per capita growth that indicates how the standard of living of the population is developing. So that's a key measurement for policymakers. In the crisis, and you see that very clearly in this chart, so in 2012, 13, 14, there's a big gap between Europe and the US. That's the result of these two crises. It also means and implies that the output gap in Europe is a lot bigger today than the United States, which means also that for the next few years, growth can be a bit higher than potential in Europe. But once that is all worked out, and I think the chart looking at the forecast already indicates that, GDP per capita growth, again, like in the past, will be very similar in Europe and the United States. So I already mentioned the two crises. The global financial crisis peaked in 2008. I will not talk about the reasons for that. Then the sovereign debt crisis, the euro crisis in the euro area followed in 2010, 11, and 12. That was the result of unsustainable budget deficits and public debt in some countries. Some countries also had a serious deterioration in their competitiveness. Other countries had housing bubbles that burst and subsequently had, therefore, banking problems. We also discovered during that crisis, or this double crisis, that we had gaps in the institutional setup of monetary union. We had insufficient supervision in financial markets, like many other countries, but also in Europe. And then the unthinkable happened. Countries in the monetary union lost market access. This is something that should have never happened. Once a country joins the monetary union, it should always have market access. But it did happen as a result of this double crisis. And the breakup of the euro area became a real threat. In response to that, we developed a comprehensive crisis strategy, which has five elements, which you see on the slide. First, the countries that lost market access had to do their homework. There was no way around that. They had to tackle the problems that led to the crisis, and they are doing that. I will show that in a moment. Second, we needed an active monetary policy, like the United States, like Japan. Third, we had to think about how to coordinate our economic policies better in the euro area. Fourth, the banking system needed to be strengthened. And finally, we closed the institutional gaps that I mentioned. We created the firewalls against the crisis, first the EFSF and then the ESM, the two institutions that I manage. Let me talk about the first aspect. Countries had to do their homework. Here you see a chart showing for these five countries that lost market access or almost lost market access. Spain was not quite in the same situation. They are all reducing their fiscal deficits after reaching peaks earlier last decade. And that's happening. There's a lot of debate about it. It's sometimes noisy. There's a debate about the speed of fiscal consolidation, but there's no disagreement about the direction, that it should happen, that it will happen. Countries will bring their deficits below 3% of GDP first and then move to a structural balance. On the right-hand side, you see that Europe in the aggregate has made tremendous progress. The euro area fiscal deficit last year was 2% of GDP, which was about half what it is in the US and UK, and about one-third what it is in Japan. The second point that led to problems was competitiveness. In this chart on the left-hand side, you see how unit labor costs developed during the first decade of monetary union. And when you, if you concentrate on the light blue line at the top, that's Greece, and the dark blue line at the bottom, that's Germany. And for Germany, one could also say Austria, Netherlands, Finland, so it's Northern Europe in a way. You see that's cumulative. By 2009, there was a difference of 50%, which meant that in Greece, unit labor cost went up 50% faster than in Northern Europe. That was not sustainable. The other countries, Ireland, Spain, Portugal, had smaller problems, but also had lost competitiveness. And the result was, you see it on the right-hand side, that the current account deficit, in some cases, reached 15% of GDP, in some others, 10% of GDP. Again, not sustainable. But you see also on the left-hand side that a lot has happened since 2010. All the countries that ran into problems have reduced their unit labor cost, and they have restored competitiveness to a large extent. Some of them had to do it through drastic measures, cutting wages, salaries, and pensions by 30 or 40%. You may have seen people in Athens or Lisbon demonstrating in the streets. The reason was that they had to accept a cut in their income of 30%. Not surprisingly, then people demonstrate. Very understandable. But it has the effect that competitiveness that was lost earlier has been restored. So this problem, to a large extent, has been resolved. Finally, still under this headline of what are the countries doing that ran into problems, they're also implementing a lot of structural reforms. It's very difficult to have one indicator that measures progress in implementing structural reforms. The OECD tries to do that once a year, and they say that the countries that received emergency financing from the EFSF, ESM, and therefore had to go through a serious adjustment program, they have implemented more reforms than anybody else. This indicator by the OECD measures the progress in structural reforms, not the absolute level. So the fact that Greece comes out as number one does not mean that everything in Greece is fine. It just means that the progress over the last few years has been stronger in Greece than in any other country of the OECD area, which includes Japan, Korea, and Mexico. It's not only European countries. And the World Bank, the World Economic Forum, they all, with different methodologies, measure similar things, progress in structural reforms, and they all come to very, very similar conclusions. So looking at this point, countries that ran into problems have done a lot to get out of the crisis, fiscal adjustment, improving competitiveness, implementing structural reforms. Four of the five countries that ran into problems are now success cases. I will show later on maybe some growth numbers. Spain and Ireland have now the highest growth rates in Europe. Portugal and Cyprus are also doing fine. Greece is a very special case, but even Greece has made substantial progress. The second point of the crisis response, monetary policy, a very important element in this crisis response. But remember, there are five elements of this crisis response, so it's one of the five. Sometimes I read it's only monetary policy that has brought Europe out of the euro crisis. That's not correct. And when you listen to what I said about what the individual countries are doing, you already understand that they really worked very hard to make this happen. And that's good, because that's a lasting will have a lasting impact. If it were only monetary policy, I would be very worried. But monetary policy did play an important role, at certain points in time, a crucial role, to move the euro area back to normal, to bring growth back and inflation expectations. I will not go into details if you have questions later, but like other central banks, the ECB has had low interest rates for a long time. The first big central bank that had negative central bank rates, actually, and the balance sheet of the ECB is also expanding strongly, although not quite as strong as the Bank of Japan. Third element of the crisis response, better economic policy coordination. This is an important element for a monetary union, because in a monetary union, the monetary policy and the exchange rate policy is totally 100% centralized. But the other areas of economic policy, structural reforms, fiscal policy, are managed in a decentralized way at the country level. So many critics have said for a long time this can never work. We believe it can work, but it needs to be coordinated well. And we have learned through the crisis that we have to do better than before the crisis. So we have done several things. We have strengthened fiscal coordination. The Stability and Growth Pact, which existed for a long time, has become stronger. The European rules on fiscal policy have also been implemented in national legal frameworks. We have a so-called European semester, where every country gets recommendations how to strengthen its growth. And there's a new procedure on avoiding excessive macroeconomic imbalances, like excessive divergence in competitiveness, which contributed so much to this crisis. So all this is in place. We have to make it work, which is never easy. But I think we have a better framework now. Fourth point is the banking sector. We created new institutions to supervise better, to identify macroprudential risks. We had seen the beginning of the so-called banking union. This happened in November 2014, where now the single European supervisor supervises centrally the 130 most important systemically relevant banks. We have a new resolution regime, a single resolution mechanism, single resolution fund. We have a new system that will lead to bail-in of creditors if public money is needed. And importantly, banks have added a lot of capital. Of course, this happened also in other parts of the world, but in Europe also. And European banks actually added 600 billion euro in additional capital since 2008. And that was a doubling of their capital. So an important additional cushion for whatever happens next. And the last and final point are the institutional innovations, the firewalls. EFSF and ESM have a lending capacity of 700 billion euro, lending that can go to countries that lose market access. We have supported five countries with 255 billion euro during the last 5 years, which is about three times as much lending as the IMF has done globally. Ireland, Portugal, Spain, Cyprus, and Greece benefited from this. Of course, only against conditionality, which means they have to implement strict reforms to get out of the crisis. Out of the five countries, four are success cases today. Ireland, Portugal, Spain have exited their programs. Cyprus will exit in March. All four countries are success cases where employment is going up again, unemployment coming down, growth pretty strong in Spain and Ireland. Greece is a special case, and they received, there was agreement on the third Greek program in the summer of last year with an additional up to 86 billion euro. So that's the story of the crisis response. Five elements, the countries had to do their homework. there was a strong response from the European Central Bank. We have better economic policy coordination, we have a stronger banking system, and we have new institutions that can deal with countries that lose market access. Maybe I skip these details in order to save time. I want to be very clear, all this does not mean that Europe doesn't have any problems today. But I think we have done a lot to get out of the crisis. And as a result, monetary union today will already functions better than before the crisis. But there's still work to be done. One is on the real economy. And here, when I look at, I want to demonstrate to you one element. As I already said, on a per capita basis, GDP growth in Europe is much better than people normally realize. It's like the US, apart from these crisis years. And our labor market is a lot better than people realize. During the last 15 years, the employment rate in Europe has gone up by 5 percentage points, while during the same period, it has dropped by 5 percentage points in the US. People are still debating the reasons for that. In Europe, the reasons why it has gone up are very clear. There was a plan, a strategy put in place in the year 2000 called the Lisbon Strategy, where systematically all obstacles to taking up jobs that existed in the tax system and the social security system were removed. And subsequently, retirement age went up in all countries and the employment rate went up a lot. So actually more people in Europe today have a job than 15 years ago or 10 years ago. And that's, of course, very important, despite the fact that the unemployment rate is so high. But it's not enough to look only at the unemployment rate. It's also important to look how many people actually have a job, while in the US, many people just dropped out. They are neither counted as unemployed, nor do they have a job. So, but the consequences with a similar GDP per capita growth, that productivity gains in Europe have been falling behind the US. That's a mathematical, arithmetical consequence. If GDP per capita is the same, labor market does better, stronger employment growth, then something has to give. And that is, in our case, productivity developments. And that's very important to realize, because then policymakers can concentrate on that issue. And that's what we are doing. And as we are moving out of the crisis, there's again more energy to do that. And that means more investment, cleaning up banks' balance sheets so they can provide credit again for a growing economy. Immigration, and I will say a few words on immigration in a moment, can help in this respect. And deepening of EMU can also help. So let me say a few words on that. Immigration is a relatively new problem. Immigration has happened in Europe throughout its history. But the numbers since the summer of last year have shot up dramatically. And that creates certainly very serious challenges. Just looking at Germany, a country that's very much affected with 1 million immigrants last year. In Germany alone this year, there will be additional public expenditures of 15 to 20 billion euro. That's about 0.75% of GDP related to immigration. Of course, this will have, in the short run, a positive impact on growth because it's additional expenditures, additional demand. In the medium and long term, it can also have a positive impact because the poor demographics that we have in Europe, as I already mentioned, following Japan with a few years lag, can be compensated by immigrants. I know in this country you also have a debate about immigration. And not much has happened. But of course, it is one way to compensate for a shrinking population when the birth rate is very low. However, this will only happen, the positive impact will only happen if the integration of those immigrants who stay in Europe is successful. And that means that's why public money is needed initially. They have to learn the language, they need to be integrated into the labor market. But if that, and that's a real challenge, but if it's successful, it can have a very positive impact on the potential growth rate in the longer term. Of course, there are all kind of social and political tensions related to this because the numbers are so big. And nobody can be certain at the moment how it will work out, whether the positive impact will play out or whether the social tension will be more important. But there's certainly a chance that this will help the European economy to overcome its a part of its demographic problems. The second broad element where more work will be done over the next few years is the completion of monetary union to make it more robust. Although I just said it will already work better after everything that has happened so far, there are still further institutional steps that are under discussion in different fora in Europe. This will take a while because the easy parts have happened the last few years. But what is debated to create or to complete the banking union, for instance, through a common deposit insurance scheme, to create a capital markets union, which would lead to more financial integration, more risk sharing through markets. But difficult issues need to be addressed here. Common taxation system, common insolvency regimes, common company law, all that is difficult but worthwhile tackling because it can have tremendous economic positive effects. And all this in the end can lead to a fiscal union and a political union where maybe the euro area has its own fiscal capacity with the euro area finance ministers. These are all points that are under discussion. It will take many, many years to create these new institutions and systems, but that's on the agenda and that's being discussed at the moment. So, to summarize, we see now in Europe a steady recovery. The numbers look low, but when you take population developments into account, growth is about the same as the United States. We did save the euro area. 5 years ago, that was far from certain. And the crisis has brought Europe closer together. We have helped the weaker countries. There's a lot of solidarity because we provide all the money at very cheap rates, low interest rates. So the approach adopted during the crisis is working. The countries have done their homework. Of course, the reforms need to continue. Productivity and potential growth, these are now the big issues that we try to deal with, and how to integrate the migrants, that's now on top of the agenda. That is the end of my presentation, but I want to say a few words about my institutions, because particularly the financial journalists among you may wonder why I am in Tokyo. And I'm in Tokyo, like in many other countries, because EFSF and ESM have to take up money in the markets first by issuing bills and bonds before we can give any loan. That's a big difference we have compared to the IMF. The IMF gets its refinancing automatically from central banks. We don't have that luxury. We go to the markets. And that's why one of my jobs, and maybe the most important one, is to talk to international investors to explain to them how we function so that they buy our bonds. And that's also what I do in Japan, like in other Asian countries, in Europe and North and South America, talking to investors. And it's important to understand that we have issued a lot of bonds during the last few years. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been able to to make our loans to the five countries, the 254 billion euro I mentioned. But this issuing activity will continue even long after the crisis is over, because our loans run for 20 to 30 countries, run to for 20 or 30 years to the five countries, while on our refinancing side, the average of our issuing activities has a maturity of 7 years. That means we need to continue to issue in order to refinance existing loans. So even if we stop providing new loans, we will still issue bonds to refinance. And that means over the next few years, we will every year be in the market with bonds for 30 or 40 billion euro. I think that's important to understand also why I am here. This shows the interest rates and where we are. Our yields are between France and Germany. We are rated AA plus or AAA. Interest rates have come down, of course, everywhere. And our investor base is very broad-based, with about 17-18% in Asia, half in the euro area, and the rest in other parts of the world. We have central banks, sovereign wealth funds, fund managers, banks, pension funds, who all buy our bonds. We are permanently in touch with the 1,000 largest investors in the world. So I wanted also to make those remarks at the very end. Happy to answer your questions on that, but also on everything else I said.
Well, thank you very much indeed for a very clear and concise presentation, delivered, if you don't mind my saying so, with Germanic efficiency.
Well, I was told very clearly that I should not speak for more than 25 minutes.
I wasn't aware of you looking at the clock, but you finished exactly at 1 p.m., which is quite astonishing. Thank you very much. Okay, so we'll go to questions now. First, from the working press. Those with questions, please go to the microphone, identify yourself, and ask your question. So, perhaps I could quickly ask a question myself, if I may, a two-part question. You mentioned certain European countries losing market access during the crisis. Do you think in this present crisis, if that's the right word, of emerging markets, certain countries, emerging market countries, could lose market access? And you also said that some of the countries in Europe have responded very well in terms of reforms. Those that received financing from the EFSF or the ESM, is that because possibly the conditionality of the lending was more strict than, say, the IMF imposes? In other words, that they have been under greater pressure to reform?
On your first question, of course, emerging markets can also lose market access. We have seen that in previous crises, during the Latin American crisis in the 80s and early 90s. We saw that during the Russian crisis in 98. We saw during the Asian crisis in 97, 98. So this can happen. I am not able to predict, and I don't want to predict, if this will happen now, where we see some stress in certain markets. Overall, I think the situation is not as serious as it was during the Asian crisis, the American debt crisis, but there are tensions. But as you asked, as a very general question, of course, this can happen. It should not have happened, let me repeat that, in the monetary union, because the member states of the euro area are mature market economies. They had to meet certain tests to be able to join monetary union. And that's also why the founding fathers of the euro could not imagine that a country once in the euro area could afterwards lose market access. That was unimaginable. To be fair to the founding fathers, it was also unimaginable to get into the worst economic crisis in 80 years. So one had to learn from that. So the answer, yes, but I'm not saying it will happen now the next few years. Among emerging markets. Your second point goes to the core of my presentation, and I wanted to make very clear that these countries that lost market access and received a lot of money from my institutions, four of the five are really doing well now. And indeed, the reason is conditionality. But I don't want to argue that our conditionality from the European institutions is stricter than the IMF. The IMF was also on board. In four of the five cases, because Spain had a special sectoral program, the IMF was part of the adjustment program. They ran in parallel with the EFSF or the ESM their own program, but it was totally coordinated. It was the same conditionality. Sometimes institutions did not agree from the beginning what was the right mix of conditionality, but that was always sorted out. The countries concerned were not faced with institutions that asked them to do different things. the institutions, IMF, European Commission, ECB and ESM, we all agreed what was the right program, what was the necessary adjustment to bring the countries back to a healthy, sustainable situation. So that worked very well. These programs were tough, yes. But you have seen that, of course, in the past. I think many of you will remember the Asian crisis. And I remember very well Indonesia, because I lived there as an IMF resident representative well before the crisis. When the crisis happened, it was also very serious. There was a lot of adjustment needed. The IMF was very unpopular, and in some cases is still unpopular. But I think it was instrumental, this program and the conditionality was instrumental in bringing Indonesia back to a healthy situation. And the same happened in Turkey, in Brazil, and many other countries where the IMF comes in when there's a crisis. That's the only reason they come in, when a country loses market access. Nobody else gives money to the country concerned. They insist on conditionality. Very unpopular. It's very tough for the population. But in all these cases, after a number of years, the countries do better than the other countries. And we have seen that Indonesia, Turkey, Brazil, for a number of years after they got out of the crisis, they were the best performing economies in the world. And the same is happening now in Europe. The countries that went into crisis 4 or 5 years ago are now coming out of it, and they are the best performing economies in Europe. Greece is not that far yet, but it's not hopeless, but they need to do more. But the other four countries are exactly the same as what we see with earlier IMF programs. Very tough adjustment, but the rewards show up a number of years later.
Thank you very much. Stanley, yes.
Stanley White from Reuters. I just wanted to ask a question about Greece. I'm just wondering what type of options are available for the reprofiling or restructuring of Greek debt. What do you think will the most likely scenario be, and how soon do you think you could conclude a deal on that? Thank you.
Yeah. That is one of the big questions now in Greece. One has to remember that Greece already received a lot of debt relief during the last few years. There was the biggest ever private sector debt relief in 2012, where private creditors gave up more than 100 billion euro of their claims, or was a write-down. And that's in parallel, the public sector provided a lot of new financing, which actually has been in the past also the normal division of labor. Private creditors who are not willing to give to a country that is in a crisis new money, they have to accept debt write-downs, while the public sector gives new money. That happened also in many other countries around the world. So this happened also in Greece so far. Greece has received more money than any other European countries during these last 5 years. There's a commitment from the European countries, from the euro area countries, to provide more debt relief to Greece if needed, and if they continue to implement the reform program. And the agreement is that what we call the first review of the current program must be concluded first before this will be negotiated. And this first review of the program that started in August last year is now conducted. We are at the beginning of this review. It may take 2 months. There's no fixed timeline, but that maybe the time needed. That needs to be concluded. This first review has difficult aspects. It will include a pension reform. It will include agreement on the necessary fiscal action to achieve the already agreed targets. So all this is not easy. It's never easy to, in no country, it's easy to agree on a pension reform, even under the best of circumstances, because pension reform always means that people have to give up entitlements that they thought were safe. So it cannot be easy, but it needs to happen. And there's no disagreement between the institutions and the Greek government that this is necessary. Even the Greek Prime Minister Tsipras said 2 weeks ago that the Greek pension system is unsustainable and will run out of money over the next 5 years. So these are the preconditions. Once we have agreement on all of that, in the context of this so-called first review, we will talk about additional debt relief. There is also agreement that there will be no haircuts, but we will do, if necessary, again, something that we already started doing a few years ago. One can think about lengthening maturities. One can have interest deferrals. There's actually, looking at the Greek debt profile, no debt overhang at the moment because of the action taken 3 years ago. The actual debt service payments of Greece today are very, very low because of our action in the past. Also, my institutions, EFSF, ESM, we charge very low interest rates. We charge our own funding cost, nothing else. That's at the moment 0.8%. The IMF, for instance, charges 3 to 5%. So we are very cheap, and the money is given for long periods of time. That's how Greece can reach again debt sustainability. So we can go a step further with that, lengthen maturities, have interest deferral beyond the period where there are no problems anyway. But we know that in 2022, debt service payments will go up, and we may want to smoothen that. So these are the options. Nothing is decided because the agreement is to start negotiating that once the first review is done. But the important element is no haircut, but helping with the debt profile, how much debt service payments are due in a given year, and there we can make some additional progress.
Thank you.
Next question. Yes.
Herr Regling, Patrick Welter, Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. I have two questions, if I may. First question is related to the Greece question. There was recent talk that the debt burden to Greece might be reduced in switching the first national credits national EU governments gave to Greece and switching these credits to the ESM, so in that way to lower credit costs to Greece. Do you think that this is a feasible idea, and do you think that it's a good idea? And the second question I have is, how far is the ESM in preparing foreign currency bonds, and are we going to see foreign currency, let's say, renminbi or dollar bonds this year?
Yes. Very good to see you in Tokyo instead of Washington, Mr. Walter. On your first question, indeed there's some talk about that, but nothing in the official circles. It would help Greece if the earlier loans, which were put together on a bilateral basis by European countries, were refinanced by the ESM because it could become longer term. Or if theoretically the ESM were to take over outstanding IMF loans. But I don't think it's likely to happen. So this is a theoretical discussion that some people are doing, mainly academics, because financially it would reduce indeed the debt service payments of Greece further. But I think it will run into serious political issues because the countries who would take over these risks are not the same countries who have the old risk. And therefore, I don't think it's very likely to happen. And again, it's not discussed in the official circles. It's more a side debate among academics who think what can be done to help Greece. And theoretically, yes, but I think politically, not very likely. I showed you earlier the bonds we have issued since 2011, the volume of the bonds, and what we intend to do in the future. Everything we have done in the market so far is in euro. Obviously, our balance sheet is in euro, our lending is in euro. So the easiest is to do everything in euro. However, over time, we are working to also issue in other currencies to broaden our investor base, because we know there are certain investors who only invest in their home currency. Certain investors in Japan will only take up yen bonds. There are many investors in the United States, for instance, pension funds, who only invest in dollars. So if we want to tap into that market and broaden our investor base, we need to issue in other currencies than the euro. This is technically a bit more complicated, so we have to prepare for that, because we would need to hedge our currency exposure. We are not in the business of running any currency risk. So that's why we have not done it, but we are preparing for that so that we can one day, and we will one day, issue in other currencies. I don't know yet which would be the first one. You have mentioned a few, I cannot confirm anything, but all of them are possible one day. It may well happen in 2017 that we go into non-euro currencies. Then we decide at that point in time which currency first.
Okay. Just before I open the floor to non-journalist members, can I just ask you a quick question myself? Since you're here in Tokyo, you said, of course, that monetary easing is by no means the entire solution to any country's problems. We're coming up to a very important meeting at the Bank of Japan this week, when there is speculation that the bank may ease again. Do you think monetary easing at this point would be beneficial to Japan? And do you think the principle of negative interest rates might be applicable to Japan at this point in time?
It's not an easy question to answer for somebody who has only been in Japan for 24 hours. And I'm sure the board of the Bank of Japan is spending days and weeks and months on that question. I think looking back, the very significant monetary easing that you have seen here in Japan has had a positive impact, like it has in Europe and the United States. In Europe, there's debate whether it has had the full expected positive impact. That is a debate, and also I remember the former president of the Federal Reserve, Ben Bernanke, said already 3 years ago that the marginal benefit of QE is coming down. So that's probably also true. So, but then I will stop here, because every country really has to look into very much in the details. I think QE as such and monetary easing has had positive impacts very clearly. And particularly during the crisis, the global crisis, this was very much needed. And as I tried to make clear during our euro crisis, that was one of the five important elements. I do not want to go as far as some commentators who say that it was only monetary policy, and I said earlier that that would be actually worrying. Other elements also played a role, but monetary policy was very important in Europe. And I think Governor Kuroda is doing a tremendous job to bring up inflation expectations, and they have come up. He has to decide with his colleagues whether more is needed.
Very quickly, is there any reason why negative interest rates are more appropriate in the European context than they would be, for example, in the Japanese context?
That I cannot answer. I don't know enough about the functioning of the Japanese banking system, whether the impact would be comparable or not.
Okay. So, unless if we don't have any further questions from the working press, if anyone else has a question. Oh, yes, Stefan, I'm sorry.
Thank you. My name is Stefano Carrera. I'm a journalist for the Italian Economic Daily newspaper, Il Sole 24 Ore. I have a question about how do you assess the situation now of the European banks in general, and regarding the problem of bank debts, because from Japan sometimes it's interesting to look at Europe, and for instance in Japan a dozen years ago or so, Minister Takenaka under Koizumi administration acted in a bold way to force banks to dispose of non-performing loans, to separate from bad loans, and 100% of analysts think now that was a very good move and helped Japan to come out of the worst of the so-called lost decades. So now, for instance, the Italian government is promoting the idea of helping the Italian banks to tackle the issue of bad loans and to try to separate and so on. Do you think that this could be a good idea or not? I mean, for a Japanese perspective, look as a good idea, but I would like to know if the issue of bad loans hanging over the banking system should be tackled in a bold way or not. Thanks.
No, thank you for that question. I think in general, there's no doubt if non-performing loans exceed a certain percentage of all assets, that is a problem for the health of the banking system and for the banking system's ability to provide new loans. And new loans are important to get the economy growing again. We also know, in particular in Europe, that the amount of non-performing loans increased significantly in the context of the crisis, first the global crisis and then the euro crisis, and that today there's still a very high share of NPLs. Of course, it differs country by country. It's particularly high in Greece again, but also in some other countries. And cleaning up balance sheet is very important. I think there's no disagreement about that. And I think Japan indeed is probably a good example where, looking back, if this had happened earlier, it would probably also have been helpful for the real economy. But then the difficult question comes, how to do it? And I think that's why the Italian government has long negotiations and discussions with the European Commission. And I'm not part of that. So I don't think the question is whether it's a problem or not. NPLs are a problem, but how to solve that problem, that is important. And in the European context, it's particularly important because we pay a lot of attention to competition. State aid rules are very important in Europe for good reasons. So whenever public money is involved, we want to make sure that competitors of the company or the banks that receives public funds are not be put at a disadvantage. That's the role of the competition authority in Europe, which is managed by the European Commission. It's a very important role to protect the single market, not only for banking, but also for banking. And I think that's exactly what is being discussed right now. I know the Italian finance minister spends a lot of time in Brussels these days to come to a solution. And again, the fact as such, I think, is beyond dispute that it would be helpful to reduce the number of NPLs, but it has to be done in a competition-neutral way. And that's the problem that's being worked on.
Martin Kölling, before I lose my voice, a short question. You were talking about saving the euro. You were also talking about the rise of populism in Europe. What impact does this rise of populism in all countries, in all bigger countries in Europe, have on your policy making, on your discussions, and then especially on the negotiations with the respective countries? I mean, especially in France, Marie Le Pen, the Front National, are growing, and she's a serious contender for the presidency. So what kind of impact does this rise has now, and what are the risks from your point of view?
Yes. First, this rise in populism, populist parties, of course, is a concern. But it's not only a European phenomenon, or let's say a euro area, EU phenomenon. You also see it in countries that are well respected and functioning well, like Switzerland, where populist parties have gained a lot over the last few years. And there are this referenda in Switzerland, as you know, closing the borders to some extent. When I look at the U.S. primaries, I also see a lot of populism. So it's not a European phenomenon. But it's a concern. And whether it's only Europe or if it's global, it's a concern. so far it has had no impact on our ability to solve the crisis, address the crisis, with one exception, I will come to that. But in general, no impact, because we are dealing with the French government, that is the one that was elected last time. Populist parties in some of our member states are not in government. The fact that sometimes government change can for a while be disruptive, because new governments need to get into their job and learn and also are entitled to have new preferences. But that has worked also on a number of occasions. For instance, in Ireland and Portugal, there were elections during the last few years in the middle of a program. New governments came in. They did not question the overall program and the targets of the program. They had their own priorities, preferences, so there were renegotiations. But in those cases, it was possible to find agreement, maintaining the targets, but finding different ways how to get to the target, which is normally possible. So the one exception was Greece a year ago. It was, I think, now exactly a year ago that Prime Minister Tsipras had his first election victory. And of course, that was a much more radical shift. They were elected to change everything. They were not elected to stay on the reform course, maybe with different policies, but without questioning the main objectives. They questioned the strategy, the policies, they reversed some of the reforms and stopped implementing new reforms. And that's why the progress that we had seen in the economic data in the second half of 2014 came to a halt, and the economy went back into recession. And then the crisis developed, and there were these dramatic moments in Brussels in July, August, when there was agreement on a new Greek program at the highest political level. After that, there was a second election in Greece last year. In September, Mr. Tsipras was elected again, however, with a completely different mandate. In September, he was elected to implement the agreed reforms. In January, he was elected with a completely different mandate to stop the reforms. So now Greece is again back on track. But during this first half of the year, there was a real, very different situation that we have not seen anywhere else in Europe the last 5 years anywhere, despite the fact that in a number of countries these populist parties are gaining more support. So it shows that it can happen, but it's so far rather unusual.
Thank you. I think we have Joël first, and then the gentleman there. Can you take perhaps just a few minutes over time? 3 minutes, 2 minutes?
Yeah, 5 minutes is okay.
Yes, Joël Legendre, BFM TV from France. Before to talk about populism, we should talk about immigration and, for example, the Schengen future. In this regard, some people have said that it would be viewed as possible to consider Greece in this issue of Schengen. You know, we are talking about it now. So what is your opinion about this issue of immigration? You mentioned that it is positive. Then if it's positive, do you think that a country like Japan could have shared the same idea that immigration is a positive thing? Thank you.
Well, I think that's relatively easy from an economic perspective. It may be rather difficult from a political perspective. But very clearly, as I tried to explain earlier, immigration, if it is done successfully, can compensate for the negative effects of a shrinking population. That, I think, is very easy to understand from an economic perspective. But then we know not all societies are prepared to welcome immigrants, or maybe only a small number. I think in most European countries, we have seen regular immigration for a long, long time, and that's very widely accepted. But now that the numbers have increased so dramatically, that's when the political and social problems begin. So, but I think that's, I don't think I can say much more on that.
Last question, yes.
Uh, Klaus, Thomas Sullivan, associate member. I noticed today you didn't say very much about Italy, but there seems to be a lot of market concern about the Italian market in terms of non-performing loans, the capital adequacy of the banks, etc. And it is a G7 country. Is Italy the next Greece?
No. If you ask so directly, I think the answer is very easy. There have always been rumors about Greece on and off since I'm doing this job. And before, when I started building up the EFSF, people said Italy might be the first candidate before Greece and Ireland even came. But throughout this period, the last 6 years, when five countries lost market access, Italy never lost market access. They were always able to refinance themselves. Even during the worst period in 2012, spreads are very, very low, interest rates are very low. We know there's a very strong domestic investor base in Italy. Of course, debt level is high, and therefore refinancing needs are high. NPLs in the banks are high, so I'm not saying there are no problems in Italy. But any comparison with Greece is just absurd.
Okay, well, I shall try to operate with equal Germanic efficiency and declare this meeting at an end at precisely 1:30. Mr. Regling, this is your first occasion as a speaker here, and that's obviously our loss. And so in order to encourage you to come back again many times, hopefully, we would like to present you with a 1-year honorary membership of the club. And thank you very much indeed for your excellent.
That's very nice to be an honorary member.
Well, we don't have to do that seriously.